Thank you, Sinha sir. Thank you for the kind introduction. Thank you, AIOS, and especially our dynamic chairman, Dr. Chitra Madam, for giving this opportunity. So quickly, I'll be speaking about the lasers in the vitreoretinal disorders. So if you look into the history, actually, how did the laser come into the picture? It was mainly because of the solar eclipse. That is when the Gerard Mayer and the Schwikar, they formed the solar coagulator. And then they took the anode pin and the cathode pin, and they formed an envelope, and that is how the birth of the xenon arc lamp was produced. So this was the first thing which was the giving a breakthrough in the laser technology. So when we compare laser versus light, the laser is a stimulated emission, monochromatic, it is coherent, and it can be sharply focused, whereas the light doesn't have that much of capacity of the laser because it is polychromatic and it is not coherent. So what are the classification? We have solid state lasers, we have gas lasers, metal vapor lasers, dye lasers like rhodamine, we have excimer lasers and the diode lasers. So most important is interaction of lasers with this tissue. So where do we see the photochemical? It is basically a non-thermal, especially in cases of PDT, where we use the photocoagulation, the photodynamic therapy. The mechanism of action is the free radical induced tissue damage. And then comes the photothermal, where we require, especially in case of MPLT, because it's also called as the fovea friendly laser, because of the short pulse bursts of laser microwaves which come and hit, which does not allow the heat to dissipate to the surrounding structures. Then we have transpupillary thermotherapy, which caused by necrosis, and then the photocoagulation, which we routinely do. Then comes the photodisruption. We all have used it, we keep using it, is in the YAG capsulotomy. And then comes the excimer lasers, where the refractive surgeons would be of great interest because it's a property of the photoablation. So coming to the next is, where are these lasers used? Both in diagnostic as well as in therapeutic. In diagnostic, we use it in a SLO, that is a scanning laser ophthalmoscope, and in the OCT. Whereas therapeutic, I have already described photocoagulation, MPLT, transpupillary thermotherapy, and photodynamic therapy. So in diagnostic, we have two different kinds. One is the scanning laser ophthalmoscope, that is called as SLO, which is basically used in case of capturing these fundus images. And then we have confocal scanning laser, that is we use it in the case of Heidelberg technology, which uses the confocal scanning laser to capture the multimodal imaging. In the OCT, again, you all must be knowing, we are now evolved into the spectral domain and now into the Fourier domain, where it is 870 micron and EDI with a 1050 micron so that it can analyze the choroidal tissues very well. So the photocoagulation, the laser light comes to the target tissue, generate heat, denaturates the proteins, that is what we call it as a coagulation, and rise in temperature about 10 to 20 degrees will cause coagulation of the tissues. So lasers commonly used in photocoagulation we use is the frequency doubled ND-YAG laser, that is the green laser, 532 nm. We also have 577 nm of the yellow laser, what we call it is a slightly longer wavelength, so it has a slightly better depth penetration as compared to this green laser. And we routinely use the diode laser as well because of the deeper penetration, around 810 nm. Then power we need to know is the parameters we need to know is the power is the number of photons, exposure time is the duration in seconds, spot size, again, it depends on the what the lens we use, the power of the condensing lens, the laser spot magnification factor of the laser lens, and the refractive status as well, whereas small in case of hypermetropic, larger in case of myopia. And lastly is the energy, where you have power into exposure time. So these are the various laser delivery system we have, is the slit lamp based, we have the LIO, and then we have the what is called as the endo laser, where we use it in while doing the vitrectomy. The slit lamp delivery, we all know that we have been using the conventional lasers now. It's a multi-spot laser. Then we use what is called as the micropulse laser therapy and the multi-spot, that is pattern scan laser, which was first coined. So it's called as the Pascal. So LIO advantages, it can treat the peripheral lesion, post-pneumatic retinopexy, as well as in case of ROP. The disadvantages are it is less stable and it definitely needs a cooperative patient. Endophotocoagulation, as I said, we use is the green laser and the diode laser. So these are the various lenses we use. Most commonly I use is the Cordra aspheric lens, that is from the Vogue, and the Mainster lens. And in the focal lasers also we have Cordra aspheric, transequator, and the area centralis. So indications, you all know it very well. Either it can be a one session, two session, or a three session, depending on the surgeon's choice. We usually use it in case of proliferative diabetic retinopathy. Even in case of very severe NPDR leading to retinal ischemia, we can use it. And what are the lasers in diabetic retinopathy, proliferative macular edema? We use the focal laser treating the leaking microorganism, and GRID is basically for diffuse edema, non-perfused thickened retina. So if you look into the qualitative assessment, CSME, focal edema, these are the features, and GRID pattern we use. But the only thing in modified GRID is we do it a horseshoe pattern because we want to avoid the papillomacular bundle. And this is how it works. That is the MPLT. The continuous waveform, you can see here in the conventional laser, you can see the left temperature bar is increasing and increasing. Whereas this micropulse technology, it inputs short pulse of bursts of lasers so that it goes up, it comes down. The moment that it comes, it's so the less heat is dissipated to the surrounding tissues. So what we have, the navigated laser, last few slides. Here is the navigated laser, NaviLAS. It's very easy laser. You can see here, it has come into the non-contact PRP as well. You can see here, you just mark it. You get the angiogramic photo, mark the photo like a rangoli, putting a rangoli here. You can see you just mark the area you want to laser. It has an excellent eye tracking system. Even if the eyelid closes, it doesn't hit it. And you can see you can mark the various lesions you want to treat and it hits it by itself. So that is how it has made the life of the vitreoretinal surgeons easy. That is called as a navigated laser. So this is how the angiographic this one looks, and we have non-contact, and we also have NaviLAS wide field non-contact PRP. So coming to the last few slides, I'll not go into the detail. Other importance is the ROP, Eales disease, retinoblastoma, choroidal melanoma, and choroidal hemangioma as well. So what is the adverse effects? Yes, definitely there are adverse effects, pain, seizures, elevated IOP, it can cause corneal damage, iris burns if you don't focus it properly, crystalline lens burns also we have seen, IOLPC damage, accidental foveal burn. So these are the various complications, adverse effects of the laser. My last slide, what is new in the laser? We have what is called as the photobiomodulation as a treatment in dry AMD. We all knew that only wet AMD could be treated, but now a lot of trials are now going on where it tries to target the selected wavelength of the near infrared light produced by the laser, and it enhances the activity of enzyme and increases the ATP generation, leading to reduction of the free radical production and oxidative damage, and thereby reducing the chance of the atrophy in case of dry AMD, and also the conversion from dry AMD to the wet AMD. Thank you very much for the patient listening.
Thank you, Dr. Srinivasan. I think you gave a really good whole overlay of the lasers as a whole for the postgraduates, and especially the things that are coming in. But coming to the basics, I think what a postgraduate would ask, and my son is a postgraduate now, he asked that, if I have anti-VEGF, I've been given a diabetic maculopathy, I've made the macula all plain, I mean, the thickness has gone down. What is the role of laser now, today, in the advent of anti-VEGF, especially in vascular maculopathy?
Very, very good question, sir. OCT-wise, we divide it as a foveal edema and non-foveal edema. In foveal edema, nowadays, we are not hitting it with lasers. We are treating it only with the anti-VEGFs. In the non-foveal edema, it will not get treated with the anti-VEGFs alone. So at that time, you might have to treat it with the focal lasers or leave it alone. If the vision is decreasing, then it makes sense to treat it with a laser. If the vision is not disturbed, it's a small cystoid spaces which is persisting, which can be observed. But definitely in case of CSME and diabetic macular edema, the role is now coming down because of the emerging of the newer anti-VEGFs, longer anti-VEGFs like brolucizumab we have now, which works for nearly 3 months, but it is just to wait for the FDA approval for diabetic macular edema. But definitely the role of the laser is coming down, but in non-foveal, we still use the laser. But if it doesn't get treated with any of these anti-VEGFs, then MPLT is also a way to go. And if the patient is not affordable with anti-VEGF, then still MPLT has a role to play because it is cost effective.
Thank you, Dr.